So I'm under no illusions about where I came from, how I got here. You know, my past, I was convicted of terrible crimes almost 32 years ago. And it's something that I can never make amends for my crimes. I went to prison in 1984, I began a life sentence. I was convicted at the Old Bailey on 2 counts of murder. That never gets easy for me to say. But you need to know, if anybody doesn't know that, that's where I came from. You know, they took me from the Old Bailey. I was with another man, I had a co-accused. There were two of us involved in our crimes. There were two of us convicted. We were separated. He went to the Scrubs, I went to the Wandsworth prison. I was locked in a cell 23 hours a day, sometimes, often, 23 and a half hours. And my life was at an end, you know, and really, I was glad. Anybody reading the reports of my conviction in the newspapers, which there were many at the time, I doubt that very few people would have cared whether I lived or died in there, you know. I didn't care personally, myself, I didn't care. I had nothing to live for, nothing to hope for. I was finished and I was glad. I had a very painful life. I inflicted pain on other people. And I could never really figure out why. I just had this dysfunctional, chaotic lifestyle which seemed to impact terribly on other people. I didn't realize, it's only looking back from my prison years when I see how much I've damaged myself. Criminals, they damage themselves badly when they hurt other people. Criminal lifestyles are very selfish. And when you live that life, when you're on the edge of society, you don't care about other people. You don't care about yourself. People who don't care about themselves, how are they ever going to care about other people? But in Wandsworth prison, I started to think, because I was sure that I hadn't been born bad. You know, I wasn't running about wanting to hurt people in jail. But I'd certainly behaved as badly as you can behave towards other people before to jail. And I started to think about how I'd become what I'd become. I became fascinated, you know, by how we become who we become. It's a complicated process. And I started to try and unravel the journey that brought me to Wandsworth, to the Old Bailey. And I went back to my childhood, you know. In prison, you live inside your head. And when you're in isolation, I was in Wandsworth prison in that cell for my first year of my life sentence. And the dreams and the imagination becomes incredibly vivid. Welcome. Welcome. And I went back and had the most vivid memories of my early years. And I was a happy kid, you know. I was born in Clevedon in Somerset. My mum and dad were from Scotland. They were teenagers, from very big poor families in Scotland. They hitchhiked to England to try and get a better life because their lives had been so basic in Scotland. But they came to England. My dad got a job as a labourer. My mum was a cleaner. And they saved their money and they bought a little house in Shipley in Yorkshire. There's a smoke-blackened house on a terrace on a hill overlooking the River Aire in Shipley. And I was born. 6 years later, my sister was born, and we looked like a happy family. When I look back on those, like, I've got photographs from those early years, got me in my office. Me in a cowboy suit, my sister in a pram, me pushing the pram. We're inveterate smilers. I've got a mop of curly hair and a cowboy suit that I had to be in bed asleep before my mother could get this cowboy suit off me. I was a happy kid. I loved and I was loved. Then when I was 7, my mother was killed in a car crash. It was a van. The driver was drunk, Charlie Rogers. He was killed instantly. My mother was thrown out of the van. She was killed. My dad was in the van. He was damaged badly by the crash. He recovered, but he was still a very damaged man after that crash. And he became a grief-stricken, selfish, violent, drunk. He couldn't cope with what had happened, what he'd lost. He never thought about us. He tried, you know, he dragged us about here and there. various relationships he had with other women he met, all of whom had other kids already, and we tagged along with these families. And it was a very odd, you know, to see my dad. He'd been a good dad. He built me a railway, a little railway set in the attic of our house in Thompson Street. And he used to build little bogey things with pram wheels and bits of wood. But, you know, he was a good dad. He's having the shoulders, you dance about, my mum. And then it all went pear-shaped when this crash happened. The violence eventually was directed towards me. And when I was 10, I bailed out. I had enough. I used to play in a little, I had a little air raid shelter. I used to play in there with my pal, Mickey, a mixed race kid. Me and him were best pals. He had a difficult life experience too as a kid. I played in there. Eventually I moved into this air raid shelter full time. And I lived like a wild boy. I used to sneak out at night, nick apples and rhubarb from gardens, and, you know, fill my face with these things. And eventually I got fed up with rhubarb and apples, and I broke into the local grocer's shop, Mr. Mann's shop. I used to pass his shop every day on my way to my den. My tongue used to hang out with his big jars of sweets in his window. Eventually I gave in and I lobbed a house brick through the window. In I went, grabbed jars of sweets, back to my den. Made myself sick, wolfing down these sweets. And I was captured by the police. Somebody in the neighborhood said there's somebody living in a wild boy in the neighborhood. The police came and they scooped me up and they put me in a police car. And I was, you know, it's funny when you're a kid, you absorb so much of what's around you. The people that you look up to, you know, you said, and I love my dad. I eventually started to hate him, but then I still loved him. And when I was in the police car, I was crying because I thought, my dad's going to give me the beating of a lifetime now. I said, please don't tell my dad, you'll kill me. I was screaming at the back of the police car. And the policeman turned to me, one of the passengers said, young man, you deserve to be killed. You deserve to be killed. I was so bad. I deserved to be killed by the police. And eventually they took me to court, and the magistrate was pointing out with this silver-haired gentleman. Until you're 18 years old, you're going away, you know. I thought I was going to prison. I was actually going to the care system. They put me into care. My dad had moved down south with some other relationship. And so I was in this home, but actually, it wasn't, you know, you hear these terrible stories about people in children's homes. I was fed and I was clothed, and the best thing about that place was I started to go to school regularly for the first time in all those years, you know, since the crash. Every day we had to go to school. And, you know, none of my family were educated, but for some reason, I was good at English. Mrs. Earnshaw was my teacher. And I was always like one of the first to get my hand up in the spelling lessons. And when Mrs. Earnshaw used to ask me to stand up and read to the class, God, I loved that. You know, I used to love standing up and reading to the class. Gerald Durrell, My Family, another animal, is that my favorite book? I used to read this book, like, all the time. I wish I could be in Corfu with these insects and this strange family he had. I wish I could be there, but I wasn't. I was in this home, and his book gave me a little bit of escapism. But the years passed, and being good at English at school never really amounted to anything. My report cards were always very negative. Mostly they said things like, Erwin is a sullen child. He has a chip on both shoulders. He's an angry child. He needs to learn to control his temper. Erwin needs to learn to communicate. I was so quiet. I couldn't speak to anybody, except Mrs. Earnshaw in the English class. I loved her to bits. But anyway, 15 years old, it came. My dad was with another family in this glamorous sounding place in the south called Western Supermare. And the guy that ran the home, he said, your dad wants your home. Western Supermare, that sounded amazing, you know. I was in this home in Ilkley in Yorkshire. When I first went there, the social worker that took me, Christ, I was crying in the back of this car when she took me in there. And when I got to this home, it was a big black stone mansion on the edge of Ilkley Moor. And she drove me to the car park, and there's a big bay window, and all these faces, these boys' faces, were all looking out the window and all looking at me. And I stopped crying. I got out of that car and I strolled in there like a little tough guy. I was 11 years old. And, well, they looked after me there. But now it's time to leave. And there was always a sense, my dad used to say, you thick, you fucking thick. He's always like made me feel I was stupid. I thick, I don't know why he said that, but I thought I was thick. So the guy that ran the home, he said, right, come on, he said, travel warrant, travel bag, new socks, new shirts, you're going to Western Superman. God, I was so excited. I can't tell you how I was more excited about going to Western Superman than I was about seeing my dad again. He said, don't forget, he took me down to the train station in Ilkley. He said, Leeds, Bristol, Western Superman. Get it to your head. I think he thought I was thick as well. I was just so quiet. They all thought I was thick. I got down to Western Superman. No, Dad. He's supposed to meet me at the station. He turns up 3 hours later, steaming drunk. Come on, boy. Take your hand. Took me home. And it was the same sort of setup. Violence, drunkenness, general sort of unpleasantness. But then I was 15 and I thought, this ain't right, you know. This is not right. So I left again. I was about 16 when I left. And I drifted. I drifted around the country. Some of the other members of my family moved to England and had some council houses here and there. So sometimes I stayed with cousins and aunts and uncles. I slept rough sometimes for weeks at a time in graveyards and allotments. I tarmacked roads. I worked in factories. I washed them in restaurants. I wanted to be a part of society. You know, I say hand on heart, I was a criminal. I was living this criminal lifestyle. For me, it was no big deal to get drunk like my dad, have a fight like my dad, smash a window, steal a car, and work in building sites. I tried my best. People talk about free will and predestined life. You know, my free will at then was to live a normal life. I wanted my will would have said, please, look. I used to look at houses, nice houses where people like you guys live. And I used to think, these nice people, how do you become one of those people? How do you live in a house like that? How do you get to join society and be a part of a community? How do you do that? Because I just didn't have a clue how to do it. But I wanted it. But the more I wanted it, the less I was able to achieve it. And I sank lower. Yeah, there's one time when I was hitchhiking south and it was so cold, it was midwinter, and I needed to get my head down somewhere. My dad, he gave me this advice, he said, whenever you get into a new town, he said, always look for a skipper. Good advice from my dad. He meant like a little place where you can go and get your head down out of the way. So I've been walking and hitchhiking for about 3 days. It's midwinter and I'm frozen. I've got a big old coat that I got from my jungle set. No traffic. No lifts, no cars. And then I saw this, I was on a dual carriageway, I saw this picnic area up ahead sign. So I thought, oh, I was about to get my head down over the hedge, the side of the road, you know. Anyway, I got to this picnic area, toilet there, in I went. And there's a cubicle, so I went to the far cubicle. I was so tired, and I locked the door and got my head, I wrapped myself around the toilet pan. Pulled my big coat up and went to sleep. And then I was awoken in the early hours by a lot of shrill voices, squealing, laughing. And I thought I was dreaming. I was disoriented. I forgot where I was. And then I realized, oh, I was in the toilet. What's this? It's children, the voices of children. And so what happened is a coach party of kids from a school or something pulled into my picnic area and let the kids in for, relieve themselves. I don't mind sleeping in a toilet. I've slept in worse places, believe you or not, I have. But I don't want to be caught in there by children. So I went real quiet. But I was barely breathing, trying to keep quiet. Suddenly it went quiet outside the toilet. A hush descended on the kids, whispering, oh, you do it, God, you, it's you, you, never look, you. Somebody looked under the door and seen me lying there. Then there was a bang on the toilet door, and I heard the scuffing of feet. And, a little head popped up over the top of the door and said, a tramp! I found a tramp! And I was like, I hit my head even deeper in my coat, you know. I thought, goodness, a tramp. I'm 22 years old, I can't be a tramp. I thought tramps were old men with beards and swag bags and they stank, you know. Well, I probably stank a little. That kid thought I was a tramp. And then some teacher came in, some adult, and said, come on, everybody. But sir, we found a tramp. He wanted to poke me with a stick like it was a squirrel or a hedgehog. And when they all left, I thought, Is this it? I'm a tramp, 22 years old, I'm in this bloody toilet. This is where I live, I'm a tramp person. Could you get any lower than that? Well, I did. I'm ashamed to say. I did get lower. I met my co-accused, the man that would become my co-accused, ended up in a squat in London. We were two failed human beings. We bolstered each other's inadequacy, I think. He was small and scrawny, but he had money in his pocket, always scamming the DHSS. I was big and sort of a big numpty, really, but I sort of looked the part. He liked a big person, and he had money, so he got the drink and I drank it. And then one night he jumped on a man in front of it after a booze up. I thought it was a fight, I joined in, turned into a mugging. And, 3 months later, our criminal behaviour left two people dead. I'm so ashamed of that. I'm so sorry to tell you that. I wish I could tell you that I went, ran to the nearest police station to hand myself in. I didn't do that. I fled the country. I fled the country and joined the French Foreign Legion, not for excitement or adventure, but to hide from my crimes. And I found a place that I actually felt I belonged, you know. Discipline, self-control, organization, a bed, food, motivation. But all the time, I knew, you know, that I was on the run. I couldn't enjoy these good things I'd found. And eventually my co-accused was arrested in this country for other crimes and told police about me. And blamed me. It was him, he made me do it, you know. Anyway, well, as soon as I found, the only redeeming feature about what I'm telling you is that I handed myself in. I left Corsica, made my way to the south of France, and handed myself into the French authorities and was extradited. And was convicted at Little Bailey. With a great sense of relief, I was glad that life was over. I didn't want to go back there, I tell you. If the death penalty were in the statute books, I would have got it, and I wouldn't have minded. I wouldn't have been appealing, whinging or whining about wanting to live. I had nothing to live for. I had no hope. I had nothing to hope for. So many people go into jail, you wouldn't believe it, with very little to hope for. But I spent my year in that prison thinking, trying to unravel that life I just explained to you. How did that happen? Was I born bad? Was I really that bad? Did I really deserve to be killed when I was 11 years old? I could read, thank God I could read in there. So I read books, 6 books a week from the prison library. I kept myself fit in that cell. Every time that door opened, there were incidences of violence in the recess. Somebody getting bashed in the recess. He's a nonce, he's a grass. There's this strange language you learn in prison. Everybody gossiping, everybody pointing fingers. Everybody ashamed of themselves, but trying to find someone else they can point a finger at so they don't feel so ashamed. And you live in this real dystopian place that all these strangers, you know, outside people think outside think all those prisoners are watching Sky TV with their mates. It's a big gang, a big club in there. Everybody belongs. They all know. No, it's a whole lot of strangers. 85,000 strangers in there. All with varying levels of dysfunction and failing, trying to survive, trying to make sense of their lives, trying to make sense of their predicament in prison, trying to find some hope. I wasn't trying to find hope, I'm not going to lie to you. You know, I was wallowing in misery and shame, and I knew I deserved what was coming to me. I didn't know I was going to live through that sentence. 99 years, that was my sentence, life imprisonment. And that first Christmas in Wandsworth Prison, the man in the cell above mine hanged himself. It was only a short term, 7 years. And I found about it in the Christmas breakfast queue. We got cornflakes there. Once a week in those days we got cornflakes. Once a year, I beg your pardon, Christmas. I love his cornflakes, Gov, said the little wags. What happened, what changed for me was being transferred to my first long-term high security prison. And I saw possibilities. There was an education department, there was a chapel, there was a gymnasium, there was an exercise yard, all these things that like possibilities. There were people who wanted to help people like me. There were counselors, there were probation officers, there were some good prison officers. There are some amazing prison officers that work in our prison. There are some people that should not ever be allowed on a prison landing in charge of fellow human beings. I met a few of those. But there's plenty of good people that work in our jails who want to help people like me, not for my sake particularly, but for all our sakes. Try and make the prison experience meaningful, purposeful. And I met some of those people. And I met one called Joan Branton. She was a prison psychologist. And her job was to assess my dangerousness. I didn't feel dangerous, I felt pathetic. But I'd been dangerous, you know, my dysfunctions had driven me to be a really dangerous to other people. But in jail, you know, I was captured. I was just pathetic. And over a period of about 18 months, you know, there were 85 men on that wing, A wing, Monster Mansion, that's what we called the prison, the locals. It was full of terrorists, serial killers, serial rapists, child abductors. We were a grim club, with barely a hope, a spoon of hope between us. You know, a very undeserving bunch. But this lady, her, she used to come on the wing, you know, no like protection or anything. A little lady, she used to come in with a little key thing next to her pouch on the side of her hip. She had a converted cell with her office. And then when she called you up, you'd see your name on the board and you would say, whoever you were, psycho caller, everywhere I would call. A psycho call-up. You try to avoid a psycho call-up. I loved psycho call-ups. I loved her. When my name was on the board, I loved her being St. John. The funny thing is, she had a big red button in this office. As you walked in, the big red button was there on the side of the wall as you walked in. So this was the alarm button. If she gets attacked or anything, she couldn't get to it because between the button and her, it was me. Or some other raving maniac. And that's how trusting she was, you know. She sat, she trusted us, she treated us like human beings. She treated us like fellow members of the human race. This very kind, considerate, caring person. Over a period of about 18 months, she persuaded me I had some value. Now that took some doing. She said, "You've got to get an education." I said, "John, I said, I'm too thick for education." She said, "None of us are thick." "Don't you say that again," she said. She was very small to me, she said, "I look like big." "Don't you, we're all born lovable," she said. "We're all born with potential." "Even me." "Even you." And so eventually I decided to go on the, I thought I'll try education. I was good at English when I was a kid. I'll try the evening class on education and see, you know. I'll fail, I always fail. And I'll tell John, well, at least I tried. But I succeeded. I enjoyed the English class. You know, I passed an exam, O-level English, grade A. Can't wait to get back to Joan's office to show my certificate. She said, "What's the name of Joan?" She said, "I was 30 years old. I was like a big boy, a big kid. I never achieved anything in my life. And then I passed this exam." She said, "I told you we all have potential." She was unfazed. To her, it was no big deal. We all have potential. Even in that place, she believed in the better good, the better nature, the better part of people, the worst of the worst we were. And I joined other classes, you know, I joined geography and all the stuff that kids study. I joined, and I started, my big empty head became full of information, knowledge about the world that I'd lived in for so long, but I hadn't been a part of. Learn about culture and history and read some amazing books. She gave me books, Crime and Punishment, Dostoevsky, Jesus, that was hard going. She gave me The Upstart by Piers Paul Reed. She gave me Cancer Woman by Alexander Solzhenitsyn. She gave me some amazing books. And I read other books. You know, I started to educate myself. and feel good about myself for the first time in my life. It wasn't all passing exams and fun and games in prison with my mates. There were some dangerous moments. You know, people outside think there are rules in a prison. Well, there are rules in a prison. The governor in his office has got big book of prison rules. But on a prison landing and a prison hierarchy, there are no rules, especially a high security prison. I was in a riot in 1990, 2 days after the Strange Riot, 25 years ago. I was in a riot in Long Martin prison. The barricades went up. Prison officers dispersed, left the wing. My next door neighbour, he was in for killing 5 people. His name was Mickey. I want to be his surname. Mickey. Let's kill the nonces, let's burn the nonces, let's kill the sex offenders. I said, Mick, let's not do that tonight, please. Let's not do that. Let's try and stay alive. I got my books, put my pillowcase, got a table leg, guarded my cell. The IRA men in the ring that night, they kept the calm. And I gave up at one stage. I thought, I don't deserve these exams, these qualifications. I was getting all sorts of things. I was achieving things, I was a bit of an achiever. And that made me feel good about myself, which I hated. And I stopped my education. Joan came to my cell. She said, I understand you. What's all this? You've stopped your thing. I said, Joan, I don't deserve this, for Christ's sake. I said, well, who am I trying to kid? I'm finished. No, you're not finished, she said. You have choices. People outside think you don't have choices in prison, but you do. You can get out of bed or don't get out of bed. You go to the workshop, don't go to the workshop. Educate yourself, don't educate yourself. Read books, don't read books. She said, you owe it to your victims to do the best you can with the life you have left. Then she closed the cell door. There were prison officers there. Closed the door and I was locked in my cell. And it took me a few days to get that into my head, to come to terms with what she said to me. Anyway, I cracked on and thought, I've got to do the best I can. I'm going to live. I've been sentenced to life. I'm going to try and live. And I did, I continued on. I became known as the guy that could write a good letter. Being good at English, prison's such a small world. Everybody knows everybody's business. And I became known as the guy that could write a good letter. And I liked that. At last, I had a place in my community. At last, I had a role. I belonged somewhere. I had something to offer other people in my circle. I could write a good letter. And I was busy sometimes writing a lot of letters, I tell you. I wrote all sorts of letters to the probation service, letters to the parole boards, complaints to the governor. I love doing those. Got a lot of vicarious pleasure from writing complaints to the governor. And I had a role. I started writing groups. I got involved in prison magazines. 14 years in, I met a yoga teacher. Wow. That was amazing. His name was Andrew James. Came to my little prison. Nothing. First of all, at the prison chapel. I hadn't realized just how stressful prison was until I met Andrew. Because I had a yoga session, he told me that what was the thing, the rag doll, what was the first thing? Oh, wow. The rag doll, you stand in what's called the mountain position, sort of like this. And then you relax and you bend forward or your back, like everything. Oh, God, the tension that was on my shoulders and my back. The relief I felt after that, my goodness. It wasn't just me, there's a group of us in this group. And I started with the yoga class. And that brought some peace into my life, into my cell. So I was the guy that could write a good letter. I was into all this writing stuff. I was surviving on the wings and landings. I was quite a robust character. I had a robust life before prison. So I was a bit of a survivor. I wasn't a goody-goody, but I wasn't a baddie-baddie. I sort of walked that middle line. And I found a way to live in there. Then the Guardian newspaper. Of all people, they invite me to write. They want a convict to write about prison life. And would you be interested? Would I be interested? I'm a writer, Don't say that to anybody. So I went to the prison governor. I said, look, the Guardian newspaper wants me to write a regular column about life, about prison life. Because outside, everybody thinks prison's a holiday camp. They're eating steak, they're eating lobster, they're in with their mates, they watch Sky TV. I said, we're all dying. We fight for our lives in here. And I said, the Guardian wants to know what's the truth. I want to tell them. No, he said. No prisoners allowed to contact the media. I said, no, Governor. I said, I don't want to I don't want to contact the media. I said, no, I'm a writer. I never said that to anybody in my whole life before. I said, I'm a writer. He goes, spat at him. I said, yes, you get another hobby. And before I could say anything, I said, oh, so I give you 50 small no's and one big no. I said, but the answer would be the same. So I scooped up. I actually had a piece published in the Independent newspaper in 1994. This was like, 1999, about 6 years beforehand. And on the strength of that, the prison service had paid for me, not paid, they supported me a grant application to the Prisons Education Trust to pay for a journalist course. So I did this course, got a certificate. I said, as the governor said to me, no, out the office, you know, sling your hook sort of thing. I said, no, I said, you supported this journalist course. And he went like that. He said, he squeezed his eyes shut. I know he squirmed. And I said, we didn't expect you to do any real journalism. I thought, you bastard. I thought, could you do that to me? You know, I didn't expect any real journalism. I could have crawled in a hole and rotted. You know, the life, our prisons, the shadows in our prisons are littered with the festering carcasses of life prisoners who give up. You know, it's hard to keep going in there. And I could have done that. I could have crawled in a hole and rotted. But I keep thinking about John saying, you owe to your victims, do the best you can. And I thought, I'm going to do the best I can with this life I've got left. I'm going to check every opportunity. I'm going to grasp it. And so I petitioned the Home Office. I got the Guardian to petition various people. I started to hope. For the first time, I started to hope. I hope I can get to do this. And then the prisons minister, Paul Boateng, he eventually gave me permission to write this columnist. That was scary. It was one of those beware of what you wish for moments. Because I looked out my cell window that night, it was raining, the prison was, you know, boom, boom, boom. It's unduly quiet. There's no noise, no drama, no nothing. I think, what the hell am I gonna write? Nothing ever happens in here. What do I write about now? But lots of things, you know, all human life is in a prison. And I started to write my column, A Life Inside. And I became, instead of being a prisoner who wrote, I became a writer in prison. I became like a long-term secret journalist on a mission, undercover. And I wrote this column. It was great to open this little window for people outside to read about our lives. Me and Big Rinty and Felix the Gambler and all these guys that I gave them new names. And I wrote that column for 4 years, 4.5 years. And then here's the funny thing. That column was quite successful. The governor said to me, I know what's going to happen. The Mail are going to write a headline, has the world gone mad? Outrage. I said, just keep writing. And that never happened. And eventually the governor brought the local deputy mayor to the prison where I was to show him around the pockets of excellence. Every prison has the pockets of excellence. You know, 600 prisons, 12 prisons doing a tailor course, 5 prisons doing an engineering course, 6 prisons doing O-level English. Pockets of excellence. All the rest are banged up or they're in workshops. Anyway, he brought him to my cell. I'd become a pocket of excellence. This is Erwin James, he writes for The Guardian. So he got 50 small nose. I said, well, pleased to meet you. I was very courteous. And afterwards, when I spoke to the governor, I said, Mr. Governor, I said, that was hypocritical. I said, you did everything you could to stop me doing that. I said, no, you're showing me off, you're a convict writer. He said, let me tell you. This was a good guy. Most of the people who work in our prisons are good people. It's a hell of a job they do, these people. Some of them get bitter, become cynical, but most of them go in there to try and do some good in there. And this was a good guy. And he said to me, the problem we have, he said, in our society, we believe in rehabilitation for prisoners, but we're not sure how rehabilitated we want them to be. And I thought, how absurd is that? If you're ever, ever going to let me out of these prisons, let me out of these bars, let me out of that cell, you've got to make sure I'm rehabilitated. Don't let me out if I'm not safe. I've not been regurgitated, reformed and rehabilitated. Don't let me out. I don't want to go out. I was lucky, you know, I was one of the lucky ones in there. I found a path for myself and I gravitated. I got my values from people like John Branton, the prison psychologist. Some of the other good people I can name, some of the people, Andrew James, you know, what a good man. I met good people in there and I wanted to have their value. times. And after 20 years, I said, sometimes when I was in church, I think, if I could just live long enough to experience one sunny day, I'll keep going. You know, so many people did. 1,247 people took their own lives while I was serving for 20 years. A lot of people, those guys, I knew well. A lot of life is, you know, 2007, 17 life sentence prisoners took their own lives. General society, they're not missed. They're murderers. But their families miss them. Well, some of them had families, some of them had people that care about them. They lost hope. But I'd started to hope. If I could just live long enough to experience one sunny day out there. And 20 years to the day, they gave me parole. I'd earned some money with my writing for The Guardian. Mostly went to charity, for 3 years I went to charity. The Prisoner's Advice Service, they help people in prison to make sure that prison sentence is being served effectively. And then last year I was allowed to keep the money. So I walked out those prison gates with hope. I wasn't very far out, and then I called, the prison officer called me back. He said, come back, shall you, mate? I didn't want to go back. I said, no, come back. He was waving, jumping. I thought, Christ, he's got the wrong day or something. So I went back and he said, come on. He said, discharge grant. I said, well, the last year I was in, I earned a few bob. I put it in the bank. I said, oh, I don't need my discharge. Thank you very much. I said, I don't need that. So I've got money in there. Oh, no, you must have your discharge grant. Oh, okay. 20 years in jail. He gave me this little pay packet thing. A few quid in there. £46. And you know what? I looked at that and I thought, God, you know, I really don't want this money. But thank God I developed some skills and abilities in prison. I could earn some money and a living, honest living. You know, it's still £46 today. It's 11 years ago almost I was released. It's still 46 quid. That's what you get released with. If you're homeless, you get £90. And then no benefits for 6 weeks. You know, we do set people up to fail in our prison system. I know, you know, if you've caused harm, distress, someone like I was, I never expected sympathy. Look, oh, you know, compassion. When I talk about prison reform, it's not about compassion for prisoners. I mean, I do have compassion because when I was in there, it seemed relevant to me that so many people had these life experiences similar to me, you know, homelessness, in the care system, drunkenness, drugs, violence, you know, problematic life experiences. There's no excuse for crime, and I'm not an excuser of criminals. I'm not a spokesman for prisoners. I'm not a flag waver for prisoners' rights. I'm not really. But what I learned in jail was that we have the potential to have a prison system that can let more people out, less likely to commit more harm, cause more harm and distress to other people, create fewer victims. If we are prepared to care about that prison, not care about prisoners, don't worry, I'm not going to say that. To care about our prison system. The costs in the region of £2.5 billion a year. The prisons and probation run about £3.8 billion a year. The cost of reoffending by people coming out of prisons. There's 70 to 80,000 people a year come out of our prisons in England and Wales. Almost 50% of those people reoffend within 12 months. When you take it to 2 years, it jumps. The different categories, young offenders, prolific offenders, but it jumps to around 75% in 2 years. The cost of reoffending those people going out of prison is in the region between £9 and £11 billion a year. That's not their thieving, that's the cost of finding them, investigations, police costs, court costs, legal costs, prison costs, all that sort of stuff. It costs us a fortune. We invest massively in failure in this country, in our prison system. That's why I'm standing here tonight. That's why I still never get tired of writing about this, talking about it. I think we deserve a prison system that delivers more for victims of crime. That sounds a bit crass coming from someone like me, someone like I was. But I never cared about society when I was a criminal, low-life life. I lived on the streets and didn't care about it. I didn't understand society. I didn't have a place there. And then I went to prison, educate myself, learn through the prison experience what prison means in society, where it belongs, what potential it has. Saw how society didn't really care about prison, watched how the media and politicians could portray prisons in a way that was disingenuous, dishonest often. This is the crime funnel, and here is all the crime. And then here is the detected crime. And then here are the convictions. And then here are community sentences, probation, also. And then here are the people that got away with it. And then here, right here, this little cone part that is the prison population. More people in prison doesn't mean less crime. More people in prison means more victims of future re-offenders unless we get our prison experience, unless we use it more intelligently, more constructively. Like, for example, the Scandinavians. Now, I'd heard when I was in jail that there were some countries that like treated people in prison like people. They helped them. They tried to solve their issues. They had problems, they tried to help, they educated, they did that. Well, in our prison system, we have people that believe in that. The psychologists that helped me, the teachers that helped me. I couldn't have done what I'd done without those teachers. Well, it was good prison officers. We have those people in our prison system, but what we're lacking. In Sweden, it's a relatively small population. But they don't like criminals. They don't like crime, the public over there. But the difference between the Swedes and us is there's no political interference in the prison's administration in Sweden. Finland, you probably don't know this, but post the Second World War, Finland was imprisoning 250 people per head of population. 250 people in a tiny population. I think it was 6.8 million, 250 people. At the moment today, in America, it's 750 people per 100,000 population. In this country today, it's 156 people per 100,000 population. In Germany, it's 85 people. France, it's about 102. But in Finland, post-World War II, it was 250 people per 100,000 people. So they had a rethink in the 60s, in the early 70s. All these researchers started to think, what is this? This can't be right. You know, people think so many people in prison for short sentences, so many people in prison for theft, so many people in prison for drunken driving, so many people for not paying their fines. There's too many people in prison. Eventually, the light bulb went on. We've got too many people in jail. So all these researchers got together and they worked out. And you know, the funny thing is, all the conclusions are exactly what I learned in my 20 years in jail. Without all this, I did get a degree eventually, but I mean, you know, I went in there without any sort of sense of what prison means in society. The most damaging offence, the group that's damaged the most by prison, young offenders. I was a young prison myself, Flockton Hall Detention Centre. It was a gladiator school. I came out of that place, I went in age 17, came out 18. I was more dangerous than I was when I went in. It was the same as Borsal. They took me to Borsal, I was in Borsal training. That was a gladiator school as well. And I came out there after 13 months. More dangerous than I was when I went in. So hope springs eternal. That's the title of this talk. I found hope in jail against the odds. Since I've been a journalist, I've been to Sweden, I've interviewed the head of the prison service in Sweden, Niles Oberg, what a guy, what a film star. Excuse me, Jeremy. Amazing character. Big, strong, assertive man. I just phoned up, can I come and see? Yes, come. Right in there. Try that in this country as a journalist. To speak to the Justice Secretary, to speak to the head of the prison service, to go into a prison and have a look around as a journalist. Try that in this country. No chance. I did the same in Norway. Because I was, you know, I heard these stories in prison about these Scandinavian places. I went to Norway, I went to a high security prison called Skien prison in Norway. Concrete and steel fortress, this was. believe me, it was a prison. I was daunting myself as I walked into this little place, little door, little red door, and a big steel entrance. And I walked in, flowers, tulips, peace, and warmth. And I walked at this back, this big chap, this big officer with a moustache, and big tough looking guy. He couldn't have been more courteous. We have courteous prison officers in this country, I have to tell you. He took me up to the education, introduced me to some of his colleagues, gave me a tour of his prison, went to the education department. It was amazing. There are these different pods in this prison. They didn't all congregate together on a wing. They weren't all out in the exercise yard in their gangs. They thought carefully about how do we keep these people in prison? How do we give them a sense that they're valuable? We want them to be valuable members of society when their prison sentence is over. How do we do that? They thought about it. They did their research. We do it in this country. I'm a trustee of the Prison Reform Trust. The amount of information available online today, you can just Google Prison Reform Trust, the Bromley briefings. It's a sort of a prison fact file. Everything you ever wanted to know about prison is in that fact file. The politicians, they can all read it. That's the difference. In Norway, in Finland, in Sweden, they don't like criminals. They don't like scum like I was. But they use their prison intelligently, effectively, and with hope. And the reason they get away with it is because there's no political interference. There's the political will to allow these people who know what they're doing, who operate the prison system, they know what they're doing, let's let them go on with it. We had a justice secretary recently, before this chap at the moment, Mr. Gove, who dictated when young offenders should have their lights turned out in their cells at night time, 10:30, lights out. This is the justice secretary. This is a young offender, young scrote, in a young offender's cell, sitting there with his misery and hopelessness. Lights out, 10:30. The problems that has caused those young kids, who the television gave them something to focus on. Now they're all screaming out in the cellars all night long, they're all self-harming, and there are all sorts of problems in there. We shouldn't have politicians. Politicians should say to the prison service, look, we want you to achieve this. Do the best, we'll support you. For some reason in this country, we've never had the political will behind the people that work in our prisons. But I've seen it in action, and here's a funny thing. This is what you want, though, is that I finished off my prison sentence in a place called Blantyre House in Kent. It's a resettlement prison. I'd heard of this place when I was in my high security jails. And like what I'd heard about it sounded like the Shangri-La of the prison system. Does it really exist, this place? You know, helpful people, the whole regime is geared to support and assist. I managed to get there in the last couple of years. What I didn't know is some years earlier, the Norwegians went to Blantyre House because Blantyre House was achieving in this country a reoffending rate of 8% from long-term prisoners convicted of murder, robbery, all sorts of serious crimes. They were going there in the last few years and being enabled and then being assisted in their transition from prison to the outside world. And they were achieving a reoffending rate of 8%. So the Norwegians came, they were interested. How are they doing this? They came over and they gave them the prisoner, Ian McLeod Murray, he gave a presentation about what was doing. The Norwegians went away and they modelled Bastøy Prison Island, the first ecological prison in the world. They modelled that prison on Blantyre House. And the governor, I went to see this prison. I thought this can't really be true. I went there and I saw these prisoners, all people like, some of whom had been like I had been, some not so dysfunctional, but still, you know, caused a few problems in their lives. And it was amazing to be, and the governor said to me, is this a prison? He said, no. He said, it's an arena of developing responsibility. Wow. And they got that from us, from Blantyre House Prison. But of course, a couple of years before I got to Blantyre House, it was a controversial place. Lots of people in the prison service didn't like it. So there was some conflict between the governor, what he was trying to achieve, and what the prison service said they wanted from that prison. And the prison service sent 84 prison officers to that jail, It's an open prison, little country place, quiet little place, you can't. Sledgehammers, crowbars, mufti suits, riot squad. They tore that prison apart, found nothing. Found nothing in that jail. It takes some doing to go to a jail and find nothing. And I got there 2 years later, and those staff, Christ, they were still wounded by what had happened to them. And they've been recovering ever since. I'm talking about 10, 12 years ago. 2000, it was 15 years ago. We had a prison. We had people motivated, but for some reason, all the politicians, prison, the hierarchy, the higher echelons of the prison service hierarchy weren't easy with treating serious offenders like I was with this sort of treatment. So you ended up, like me, you know, I look back on those 20 years, and I swear to you, I'm grateful for what that prison experience gave me. I'm grateful I live in a society that was prepared to give me a second chance. I'm not going to tell you I deserve one, because I don't think I did, but I got one anyway. But I know that I got through that time, really through chance, through luck. I grabbed some opportunities, I met some amazing people in there. I had my own agenda, I had the ability to duck and dive and get out the other end with something to allow me to live like a normal member of society. Most people don't manage it. A lot of long-termers, they don't manage it, especially lifers. I'm not saying we should be sympathetic, you know. But if we put people away, most of those people that go to our prisons, they come out. There's only about 50 people in the whole of the prison system, never to be released. People like Rose West and the Yorkshire Rip and the usual icons of hatred that we've created. No way you've got a serial killer. He works as a community worker now. He did 21 years. Now he's not a community worker. He killed 8 people. Shocking. But they manage their prison system. They manage their PR, the way they express what they do in their prisons. They manage it well so the public know that the best outcome is being done on their, in their name, their tax money, so that there are fewer victims of people released from prison than would otherwise be the case. And I'm not sure why we don't care that much in our society. But I think we have some questions now. I think. Thank you very much for listening to me.